Old Testament reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 5. He who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income. This also is vanity. When goods increase, they increase who eat them. And what advantage has their owner but to see them with his eyes? Sweet is the sleep of the laborer, whether he eats little or much, but the full stomach of the rich will not let him sleep. There is a grievous evil that I have seen under the sun. Riches were kept by their owner to his hurt, and those riches were lost in a bad venture. And he is a father of a son, but he has nothing in his hand. As he came from his mother's womb, he shall go again, naked as he came, and shall take nothing for his toil that he may carry away in his hand. This also is a grievous evil. Just as he came, so shall he go. And what gain is there to him who toils for the wind? Moreover, all his days he eats and drinks in darkness, in much vexation and sickness and anger. Behold, what I have seen to be good and fitting is to eat and drink and find enjoyment in all the toil with which one toils under the sun, the few days of his life that God has given him. For this is his lot. Everyone also to whom God has given wealth and possessions and power to enjoy them and to accept his lot and rejoice in his toil, this is the gift of God. For he will not much remember the days of his life, because God keeps him occupied with joy in his heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from Hebrews chapter 4. Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest, as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in this passage he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news fail to enter because of disobedience, again he appoints a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterward, in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, in discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him, to whom we must give an account. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
and said to his disciples, "How difficult it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God." Peter began to say to him, "See, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or lands, for my sake and for the gospel, who will not receive hundredfold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. gospel today, but if you look at the first verse of our Old Testament lesson with the words of wisdom from Solomon, he says, he who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income will be satisfied with his income. And right there is the very theme of what we have also coming out of our gospel lesson. Hold tight to anything. You hold tight to anything besides God, and you won't be satisfied with it. You'll turn it into an idol. So the lesson we want to learn today is to hold loosely to your daily bread. When you think of the Lord's Prayer, and you've got seven petitions in your Lord's Prayer, six of which really speak of eternity. The middle petition speaks of our daily bread, and we all do pray for our daily bread, don't we? Our health, the things that are going around in our lives, those things that we know we have now, but we won't have in eternity, at least not the way we have it now. That middle petition is about our daily bread. It's about those things you and I ought to thank God for because they are blessings, but we are to hold on to them loosely, very loosely, much more loosely than you hold on to them today. We are continuing the discussion, and really this is really connected very much to the gospel lesson of last week when the rich young ruler asks, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And remember Jesus' answer? Give up everything. Give up everything and follow me. Give up all your daily bread and follow me. So, go ahead and do it. Why aren't you going to do it when you leave church today? I'm not going to do it when I leave church today either. But this is what God says. Give it all up. Are you going to give it all up? No. But it is true, right? Jesus isn't pulling your leg. He says, give it all up. All must be given up. And you're not going to give it up. So what hope do you have? Well, as good Christians, I hope you know where I'm going with this. Because Jesus then says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man, you, to enter into the kingdom of God. And of course, the disciples say, what does this mean? Now, there's a lot of discussion about the eye of the needle. All I'm telling you, but what Jesus is saying is the big thing, like a camel, which is the largest animal they would have seen, can't go through something that is the smallest thing. So in other words, he's moving towards the impossibility of this happening for you, you see. And so then the disciples conclude very, very well. So how is anybody going to ever enter into the kingdom of God? What hope do we have? And then Jesus says, what we just sang about, or the choir sang about, and that is why? It's impossible for you, but not impossible for God. All things are possible with God. That sets the whole reference, and you come to conclude, so who's going to fulfill this? If I'm not going to leave church today and give it all up so that I can follow and enter into the kingdom of God, because certainly I believe that my eternal life is more important than anything else. And so do you, right? All of us believe that, right? Even though we don't act like it, see? Because you and I hold on too tightly to those things that are going away. But Jesus didn't, right? He knew I was going there, right? Jesus is the one who came from the right hand of the Father, entered into the humanity, and it was God who gave up everything, not you. It's interesting that Jesus said, if you're able to do it for yourself, give it all up, follow Christ into eternity, that would save you. None of us can do it, but God does it for everyone. See? God gives it all up. Jesus gives it all up. God in human flesh, his righteousness, gives it all to the poor, just like you and me. So now there's faith, right? And there's trust. We understand that Jesus did it all, right? This gets you to run. You hold on to this faith. And now you want to talk about your daily bread on a given basis, right? Because you have your daily bread. Christian faith enables us to begin to see, dear friends, divine blessings and how the divine blessing relates to your daily bread, for one, because Jesus makes this in our text. He segregates these two things. Our faith makes us look at our daily bread and eternity differently. And it all has to do with holding on to everything you have loosely. You hold on to everything loosely, and you will see your daily bread for something better than you see it now when you hold on to it tightly, and you'll have your eyes on eternity. Christian faith causes you to see your daily bread differently than when you hold on to it tight. When your grip is so strong on it, like sand, you grip it, you hold it, and it goes through your fingers, and you don't even enjoy it. That's what Solomon is saying. Christian faith is all about total dependence on Jesus, who gave up not only a life like yours and mine, he gave up his place of glory, entered into humility. He who knew no sin became sin for us. He who knew no sin didn't have to give up everything because he had something wrong with him. He gave up everything because he saves his creation. What you would need to do to inherit eternal life, namely give it all up, it's not yours to fulfill. So Peter says, after all of this, well, we gave up everything. We gave up and followed you. It's very interesting. I wonder about Peter and where he's at by saying this. I have my suspicions that he's still trying to earn his way to heaven when he says this. He says, we gave up everything, but he really didn't. He actually kind of sounds very much like the young rich ruler who, by trying to manage things, remember the young rich ruler? He said, oh, I've obeyed the commandments. And Jesus basically concluded, no, you haven't. Peter sounds the same way when he says, we have left everything. And Jesus answers this, and this is just remarkable what he says. Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brother or sister or mother or father or children or land for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100-fold. So all the rewards you're going to receive. Then he says this, though, now in this time, that's now, you giving up everything and recognizing those things gives you blessing now in this time. Then he goes on to say it again, house and brother and sister, he does not say father this time. Very interesting. He omits that mother, children, and land. Then he says, with persecution and in the age to come. Let me just show you what's going on here. Jesus is saying this, the same thing that the King Solomon was saying, but then he puts everything in its total perfect position for you to understand that you're seeking eternal life. Because he says, you'll get your blessings here within persecution, and then you'll have them all forever. Beautiful. I would suggest he's saying, hold on to everything very loosely, all your blessings, and you will enjoy your blessings because you hold them on that way. Because if you hold on to them tightly, all you're doing is taking your daily bread, the finite blessings, and you're turning them into the idol that they aren't. And if you turn your daily bread, whether it be money or a person or a position or what have you, if you turn that daily bread into your idol, it replaces God and therefore it becomes filthy. See? And then you won't even enjoy those things you're holding on so tightly, thinking that they're forever. You won't even have an eye on eternal life. Because you're going through persecution in this life. And so I ask you the question, are you going to give it all up? Well, no. But then again, yes. Through the persecution of this life, and let me put it this way. Let's just talk about persecution in its extreme sense. Let's take a martyr. Let's say you are in the position like many people are today around the world. And you are asked by somebody who's about to take their life, will you renounce your faith in Christ? To renounce your faith in Christ is to give up everything. And you say, no, I will not renounce my faith in Christ. Like you said when you were confirmed, I will not renounce my faith in Christ. And you are martyred. You will at that moment, what? Give up everything. And you'll do so with the faith knowing that when you give up everything, you're going to enter into eternity. That's extreme persecution. Right? That may not happen to you. In fact, it doesn't happen to most people. But you will what? Go through a life of persecution and then you will die. And in your moment of death, you are going to what? Give up everything. So you will give up everything, but it's a whole different life. It's not where you're going to give up everything now in order to earn Jesus and earn eternal life. It doesn't work that way. That's a law-driven thing. But the gospel is this. Jesus gave up everything, so I look at everything differently. I look at my daily bread differently, and guess, lo and behold, in the end, all of that will be given up. In and through the grace of God and the faith that God gives to us actually becomes joyful in the fact that our daily bread is being given up through the persecution unto eternal life. So when I understand that today, I think of my money, I think of my position, I think of my wife and my children and all the wonderful blessings that I have. God is telling me, enjoy them. Hold on to them loosely. We're giving up everything for the rewards that are 100-fold, says Jesus, rewards that you never earned in this world, even though you do good works because of faith. He will give you 100-fold into eternity. Isn't that beautiful? The only way it is impossible with man, but not with God. It takes the total surrender. And I don't totally surrender to Jesus. Jesus totally surrendered to his Father. And now I have grace. Now God is telling me, the persecution will see to it that you will lose all your daily bread and in its place gain something so wonderful you don't even begin now to understand the beauty of the kingdom of God. Hold on to things loosely. The joy of holding them loosely becomes a joy of the things that you have and a real joy of the things that are coming because of the merits of Christ. Amen. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all our human understanding keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.